This is a light from 1971 that is controlled by and charges my phone. But it didn't start out that way. It was on sale for 25 cents, but the thrift store manager said,
"Just take it."
And when I plugged it in, it actually worked. But the light flickered, and the battery was discontinued 50 years ago. Still, it felt like the universe was telling me this was the camping and video light of my dreams. I'd been using this light tube, but the battery life is trash, so I figured, why not merge the tube with the vintage light and attempt to make a giant battery for it? Oh, nothing could go wrong. So I tore the light tube down into this light strip that has different tiny LEDs for each color, this rechargeable battery that I'll be replacing, and this printed circuit board, also known as a PCB. This PCB hosts the display, the buttons, and the charging port all on one thing, which presented me with my first problem. See, I thought the guts of the light tube would be separate pieces, and that I could put buttons in one of the Safari Light control panels and the display and charging port on the other side. But the PCB was just one long thing, and it wouldn't fit. So I stared a while, looked at it from different angles, and an idea that involved cutting into the light slowly formed. As I tore down the light, I started noticing all the little details. The worn engraving of the patent number and where it was made. The name and address of the man you're supposed to send it to for repair. I even found this melted wire that probably made this pretty dangerous for the month I've been using it. Okay, that part wasn't that cool. But breaking it down and cleaning it up gave me the morale boost I needed to push forward. So I started to actually build something. I bought these modem batteries a few years ago from Jehu Garcia and finally had an excuse to use them. Inside was a bunch of the same rechargeable lithium ion cell that was in the LED. They looked a little rough, so I gussied them up with these stickers to prevent shorting, then busted open the LED's battery to harvest this little chip that connects the battery to the aforementioned PCB. After confirming the LED's battery and the recycled cells were the same voltage, I put 20 of them in these plastic battery spacers I bought so I could wire them in parallel to keep the same voltage, but 20 times the capacity. To make them all into one mega battery, I cut a strip of this conductive nickel material for the top and bottom and started spot welding with this sketchy contraption that shoots out little bursts of electricity and fuses the strips to the battery, creating a solid electrical connection between the cells. The last step was to connect the little chip from the original battery, but the tabs on either end were too short for the new, bigger battery. So I tried to weld extensions on, but that didn't work, and I was forced to face soldering again. But with the help of these little lobster hands, it was actually pretty easy. With those extended, I hot glued the chip to one of the cells, then welded the tabs to the battery. I plugged it into the LED PCB and was honestly kind of shocked the display turned on, so I finished that up by wrapping it with heat-resistant tape and heat-shrunk the whole thing to form a semi-legitimate-looking battery. But the battery didn't perfectly fill the cavity inside the Safari light, so I modeled some supports and printed them to hold it in place. It was looking good, so I immediately cut it open, because it's pretty stupid to have this giant battery and not be able to charge devices with it. This JST cable soldered to the battery allowed me to access its power. I made sure it was working, then heat shrank the battery back together, and now I had two connection points. One delivers around 4 volts to the light, and the other outputs power for charging my phone. But to get that to work, I had to level up the soldering skills again. And it turned out not too bad. This bad boy is a voltage booster, and when I plug in the battery, it takes the 4 volts from the battery does a little magic trick and spits out 5 volts, which is what my phone needs to charge. And to bring it into the modern era, I used this USB to USB-C adapter for the power port. Now you can see I have power coming from an outlet, flowing into the LED PCB. From there, energy flows into the mega battery and recharges it. The mega battery obviously powers the LED with this cable, but it also sends power through the voltage booster and then into the USB to USB-C adapter to charge my phone.
Clear as mud!
With that working well, I started destroying the Safari Lite control box, where I originally wanted to place the LED controls. With that not being an option, I thought this would be a good spot for the batteries in and out ports. There was some cool looking stuff in there. Some ancient capacitors or resistors, the original power button. No clue what this thing is, but I didn't feel too bad about destroying these old electronics because of the melting wires. Now that the brain of this thing was stripped out, I printed some parts to hold the power ports and the voltage booster. I inserted these threaded fasteners using this tiny drill press method I stole from Mars Gizmo to make sure they go in perfectly straight. Once those were inserted, I bolted them to the original metal box using the mounting points that were already there. With that assembled, I inserted the ports and the voltage booster, then added a little hot glue to hold it in place, and in theory would be able to charge the battery with the white port and charge my devices with the black one, once it was fully assembled. And now it was time for the part I'd been avoiding, because the stakes were high. So I measured once, then again, and I still didn't feel ready, but I started cutting. I was in a state of flow. If I destroyed this piece of history, I'd probably never find another one.
Yo, there's like 100 of these on eBay.
So anyways, I made the most glorious hole that anyone had ever seen, and it's where this control panel was going to go. To attach that, I added a few of the threaded inserts and made sure I'd be able to access them via the hole. Then, I printed a new housing for the LED's PCB. It consists of these two pieces that sandwich the PCB. This little sandwich sits on the inside of the light. From the outside, I added the control wheel, then placed the new control panel and tightened it all down from the inside. It was starting to look like a real product, and now I just needed to mount the LED panel. I printed these risers that clipped on to the existing light hardware, and the plan was to mount the LED panel to those so it would sit in front of the PCB. But the LED's ribbon cable was about 2 inches short. Luckily, there are ways of fixing that these days. I chopped the little guy in half, spliced in some extensions, and sealed it back up. I wouldn't say it looks perfect, but it should get the job done. Okay, now I was able to plug in the LED and mount it to the risers. But to diffuse the light, I decided to add a few layers of vellum. I mounted a strip of it close to the LED and 2 more layers on the front cover of the light to hide the electronics that weren't supposed to be there. And with that, just about everything was made, so I started putting her back together. I connected the white extension cable to the PCB, slid the battery into place, connected it to the voltage booster, and the rest of this old bird was pretty easy to reassemble. After a few finishing touches, I was ready to fire her up. This thing should run for around 18 hours, and it easily charges with the USB-C in port. And with the out port, I can charge my phone. The LED was already Bluetooth, so I'm able to adjust brightness and color, and it can even do effects. The control panel was printed on a textured bed and painted matte black, so it works with the original materials really well. The display shows my settings. I painted the power button to mimic the original one, and I can navigate all the menus with this scrolly wheel. I love this thing, and I hope it sticks around for another 50 years. But more importantly, I hope it inspires you to make something just for fun, even if you do it alone in a basement.